insurrection. What a great moment this is. What a powerful catalyst for change. And what a shameful moment. Yet again, we have to confront gender inequality as a humiliating cultural reality. To admit how deeply it is embedded in our lives and in our work, and how clearly this inequality intersects so many other discriminatory practices, not only in the Abbey, not only in the theatre, and not only in Ireland. It is way past time for an act of rebellion against the hierarchies and the autocracies that we have almost always accepted as insurmountable barriers. It is way past time for many great artists, who also happen to be women, to reclaim their rightful place in the artistic canon of this country. It is entirely appropriate that the Abbey stands at the initial site of our descent today. The Abbey Theatre is our theatre. It belongs to all of us and to no one. The principles of any national theatre have to be founded on equality and inclusiveness, particularly one as symbolically important as the Abbey, and especially in a program which sets out to interrogate the insurrection of 100 years ago. And here we are at a great moment. Today, here and now, wherever we are, is the opportunity to examine our practice, to reclaim our theatre, beginning with our national theatre, by transforming it into a site that can lead by example, by listening, by inclusiveness, by non-autocratic artistic leadership and real interrogation. It will take a while, time is running out, and we mustn't stop for a second. Huge thanks to Leanne Bell, who started the fire. Long may it burn.
Rage in women is terrifying, and it doesn't come out of nowhere. The rage comes out of being said no to one too many times when you should have been said yes to if the world were fair.
pride that that's because I'm directing a one-woman play by Stacey Gregg. I've been watching from afar because that's how it feels from the northern perspective of theatre. Always on the edge, peering through the window, never mind smashing the glass ceiling. My experience of growing up in the north and my work in Bosnia eradicated any sense of romantic attachment to the idea of nationhood. I find the concept of nationalism, and therefore a national theatre, difficult. I cannot relate to it either in regard to the Abbey or the Lyric. But I do know that to direct in either building would feel like a seismic shift in my career trajectory, which has been varied and circuitous, and like many before me, only possible through the support and mentoring of brilliant women who believed in me when I didn't believe in myself. This dialogue is challenging on so many fronts and goes far beyond the Abbey 2016 programme. If the experience and underrepresentation of women playwrights is a disgrace, where would we even begin to address the daily humiliating scenarios and grinding sacrifices made by our women actors? The prejudice is deep and internalised. This past week, I have looked at myself and my company Prime Cut, and when I look back at the 23-year catalogue of our work, I find us wanting. It is not just the major institutions that are holding their heads in shame. I can say that we are deeply committed to empowering the next generation of women theatre artists. We are putting our money where our mouth is. Our company is female-led, empowered, and empowering. Maybe we have had one eye open and one eye shut. Maybe we are all wide awake now.
She's black, she's got dreadlocks and a samurai sword. Well, you can't just stick yourself in it, he laughed. And I argued, but I'm the writer, aren't all the characters me? And then I took it. And now I have a dark human story to tell. Written, directed and performed by me. Except it won't be performed by me. For this dark human story to receive as a valid story that it is, I shall have to cast a white woman, otherwise to be relegated to the black story pile and seen as a black issue. So dear Abby, this is the problem. To paraphrase the wonderful Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie's TED Talk, The Danger of a Single Story, you, dear Abby, are propagating a single story. A single story of Ireland, a single story of Irishness, a single story in which I simply don't exist. But guess what? I do exist. And right now, well, I'm mad as hell and I'm not gonna take it anymore.
My name is Zia Holly and I'm a lighting and set designer. I grew up in a house of boys.
writers, directors, producers, designers, composers, actors, stage managers, production managers, men and women alike. This movement is powerful. There is a force behind it. It has changed my perception. I've realised I don't feel like I need to be one of the boys anymore. I'm proud to be one of the girls.
Sexism in all shapes and forms. If you were assertive as a female actor, you were called a diva, aggressive, bitch, difficult to work with, high maintenance, ball breaker. I've never heard men spoken about in that way for voicing their opinions. If you question the imbalance in theatre in terms of gender, you can be called a man hater. So you stop speaking out because you're frightened of not getting work from the men who mostly have the power to give you work. I thought when I became a theatre maker it would be different. While I've had incredible support over the last 2.5 years from men and women in theatre who aren't afraid to support middle-aged female voices, it's still a struggle to be heard. Sexism is not confined to theatre. A friend of mine is a novelist, and she says she faces the same random sexism in the literary world. A friend of mine who works in the corporate world says she faces similar acceptable sexism every day. The struggle goes beyond the Abbey, beyond the arts in Ireland, and is deeply rooted in Irish society, and therefore there's a lot of work to be done. It's not a malicious imbalance. I don't think the men in theatre who make the decisions sit in rooms plotting ways to increase equality towards us. In fairness, I think they would have more sense than to deliberately take on any of the women who raised their voices over the past few years. Instead, this acceptable prejudice is so ingrained in society that it is the norm. Women have a huge role to play in changing things. It's not all down to the men. We need to support each other and acknowledge sexist situations together when they occur. Things can't go back to the way they were now because awareness has been raised and our voices can't be ignored. The fire has been lit, and any fear I had about speaking out is well and truly gone. I don't want special treatment as a female actor or as a theatre maker. I want equality.
Unfortunately, however, when that work can't find an outlet, I can't let the writing do the talking, and so I have to do it myself. Playwrights, all playwrights, are in an unusual position. Like other writers, our work cannot exist solely on the page. Plays live and breathe in performance, so plays which are not produced essentially do not exist. It is therefore simply not enough to commission a playwright. The real test is to produce that playwright's work. I've worked at the Abbey before, and I believe there's no lack of goodwill here towards commissioning female writers. Yet what we're not seeing is the work of those writers make its way onto this stage. Is it that the plays we're writing are not seen as big enough, relevant enough, or national enough? It has traditionally been asserted that men write plays that are big, historical, social, political, while women write plays which are small, domestic, relationship-driven, personal. Aside from the fact these are gross generalisations in every way, the truth is we don't really know what women are writing about because we're not hearing from them enough. Yet women are being commissioned by this theatre. The implication, therefore, is that whatever it is we are writing, it does not accord to the concept of national theatre. It seems obvious, then, that we need to change our concept of national theatre to include women and what women want to write about, rather than asking female playwrights to conform to tired templates of what a national play should be. We need our national theatre to risk making a commitment to that which it has commissioned. That way our work could speak for us, and we wouldn't need to stand here speaking for it.
Of the very value of the art form. None of us, actor, director, technician,
in this sector consider ourselves to be particularly well paid, but some of us are more equal than others. I come from the relatively unthreatening security of the costume department. My craft is seen as essentially feminine, and indeed it is one area where the majority of practitioners are female. But still, I look at my paycheck at the end of the production, having spent on average 3 months of dedicated and skilled work, and I ask, is there an unconscious gender bias to the value placed on one design discipline over another?
Nothing tangible is yours or mine. We rent, but we might always rent, or live with parents we don't want to resent but do. There's a queue of women with ink-stained fingers and pages full of life on Abbey Street, and we're plowing through the stars one more time and murdering Desdemona post-prayer. We're there, 100 years after and 400 years since, and dead men are still taking precedent over living women. Nothing new. No new stories told, not for the sake of not hearing the old. Hundreds of students who may never work. Why educate if we can't translate these words that live in us to stage? These words live in us, and we're giving up and going away and getting jobs we never wanted to support lives that we hate. I will always rent if I get to live on a stage. I will not own if I get to tell my story how I think it should be told. I will stay if you will have me, but I won't wait. For every 1 in 9 decision you make, 8 will leave or give up or think I wasn't good enough. Well, tough. The pool will get smaller. When you only listen to half of us, you only get half the story. We shouldn't need to hashtag wake the feminist. We've been awake so long. It's you that is sleeping. And when you wake, we'll be gone.
Several women practitioners and academics have been kind enough to cite the company as an influence and an inspiration. But here's a quote from me speaking in 1983. We were frustrated by the lack of good roles for women and decided we'd have to write them ourselves. We were tired of playing somebody's wife, somebody's girlfriend, somebody's sister. We wanted to be this somebody. And last week in 2015, I read Joe Cummins of Moonfish Theatre Company, frustrated by the lack of good roles out there for women, we knew we'd have to set up our own company and write the material ourselves. Roles where we could play more than merely the female appendage for the male protagonist. 32 years in between. Any wonder I'm desperate for some sleep? Saying they were feminists because they didn't know the theory. You are the living, breathing essence and epitome of singing, all dancing, hard-working, fact of it, make 2016, not just in our sector, but in all others, the estrogen rising.
Female writers making amazing work. These are not obscure places to look if the Abbey was serious about fostering and developing a diverse range of voices. And if these female writers aren't given the opportunity to make the leap, how will things ever change? Historically, there has been a shameful track record of gender inequality on this stage, and this should be made an urgent priority when programming. We are, after all, half the audience, more than, and we were also around during 1916. You would think they would have had the foresight to have anticipated this and would have been looking for the past few years to commission. They wouldn't have had to look very far. It begs the question, why should I go and support my national theatre when I cannot see the female voice being represented or respected? Thanks very much.
Hi, I'm Max McCullough. I'm an actor and I'm reading for the writer Lisa Tierney Keogh. I wrote my first play 14 years ago. I've watched conversations about the lack of women playwrights surface again and again, and every time I think to myself, no, there isn't. Over the years, I learned to suppress the pain of being overlooked and ignored, the pain of being constantly pushed back. I watched my male contemporaries being produced and celebrated as I kept plugging away, trying to hush that quiet voice inside me that kept saying, this is wrong. I was a member of the Abbey Theatre's inaugural New Playwrights Programme. I was under commission here from 2010 to 2012. I'm one of those women playwrights for whom it just didn't work out. Except that's not the truth, is it? The truth is, the odds were stacked against me because I was born a girl. I had a less than 15% chance of actually getting my play on stage in my own country's national theatre. The hurricane inside all of us will change this. There's no going back now. There can be no more quiet. There can be no more hush. There can be no more shoving us into a corner labelled reading series or short plays, the programming equivalent of a snob. That's your place, ladies. Off you go and sit in it. I want a future where Irish women are equal, included, and not just tacked on as an afterthought to their national theatre. I want to know that if I pour my heart and soul into writing a play, I at least stand a chance of being at the table. I implore all of us to remember and honour the bravery and courage of the women who fought for our independence. They fought for us, so that we would be free, so that we would be equal. Let no one tell me I'm not ready. I decide when I'm ready. You decide when you're ready. And let me tell you, we're all ready.
It took the setting up of my own company,
with my sister Marie to eventually be able to devise theatre bilingually that offered us and the women who comprise our ensemble fulfilling roles in the creation process and challenging and multifaceted characters to play. Tádhárfaí lin mar chólachtar chlóníochta, achasation in annum, shachas buichasle, institúdi cosúla áirchlan na manistrach. Nír rachmar gur alti, núgur wall áirchlan na manistrach muidaríf. Tá warsin rinamar an cina gan íirachtí an of cadrúf ar annum. Gan lianacht orin e chnage ar an horas sin a bhí dúnta in ar nai. In áitsin, tomatéis ar bhuinniuv a íru ar áirchlaníochta crochu ar ar malach féin. Our community gone back in the inshna, back in the tanga, new back in the call prohibitor e. We have been successful, but this has been despite not because of our relationship with theatrical institutions such as the Abbey. We have never felt welcomed or encouraged by the Abbey. We have reacted to this by choosing not to engage, not to beat against a door that stayed steadfastly shut. Instead, we have put our energies into creating theatre on our own terms. Theatre that provides roles that are not gender defined, theatre that is not defined by language, and theatre that is not defined by where it is created. Tháirclann na manistreach, heisibhe mar orsa díocúchta dúine, agus tá alaintóirí eile cosúil linne, ach creidim go hiomlán go bhféadfadh sé a bheith mar orsa láidir cúchta dúine. Bhí tríthe in ar léiriú déarnach, go mbíonn dearca dúiltach orthu go minic. But the law is more of these clear of the crew, the Guelga am. Agus crochu tiva mo de via clie. Who is our concourt noshunta a de on an exul amina, agus dilo mache. Mos fetur lin eshina wants mach, gan takilt on our art noshunta. Sauli kadavet of muta, agus aliatori ela kosu lina, a wants mach lenagus takilt. The Abbey has been a force of disempowerment for us and for other artists like us.
Because Gary and I founded our own company, and by the way, me Larry said, good Annie Gerlings. we were able to make our own weather. It was only in later years, as we came more and more into contact with the professional theatre, that we realised with a shock that women's voices had to fight to be heard. Both of us have long acknowledged to the other that if we had tried to become an actor and director by the established route, neither of us would be working in the theatre today. We are speaking today to make sure that that never happens for any of the young women coming up behind us. Wales.
So what happens next? How can the Abbey begin to make reparations for the years of exclusion it has, if unconsciously committed? Commissioning new work by women playwrights is an immediate imperative, but it will take time for these commissions to reach fruition, and it's likely that they won't reach the stage within the tenure of the current director. So what can the Abbey do now? Ensuring that women directors and designers are represented in the remaining part of the 2016 programme is an absolute necessity. This will not be difficult. The independent theatre sector in Ireland is led by women, whose work tours nationally and internationally to wide acclaim. So too is looking at the body of work not commissioned by the Abbey that Irish women playwrights have presented elsewhere in the last 10 years to great acclaim, and bringing that work home so Irish audiences can enjoy them. A lot of these writers and directors have been ignored by the Abbey for so long and have made their own successes elsewhere with busy schedules, so it might take some time and some work to persuade them to take a job at the Abbey, but that work should start immediately. In thinking back on what the Abbey could or should have done differently, the canon is an area that needs to be addressed. To my shame, as a woman, a feminist, and somebody who studied Irish theatre history, my knowledge of the work of Irish women playwrights between the work of Lady Gregory and the 1990s is paltry. I don't think I'm alone. The Abbey needs to shed light on this work and share it with the sector. This can start immediately. For example, working with the Playography Project and the Abbey Archive, to start a reading group with writers, directors, designers and producers in the sector to make a commitment to produce work from the canon of Irish women playwrights over the next 5 years.
My name is Tanya Dean, I am a dramaturg, and I also currently lecture in drama at NUI Galway. Recently, I instigated the hashtag Fair Play for Women pledge on Facebook and Twitter, which is a promise to book one ticket a month for a year to see a play by a female playwright or artist. But what I want to consider today is, what is behind the systemic inequity that restricts female representation and participation in Irish theatre? And it is systemic, it is cultural.
when we write plays or make plays or design plays or act in plays, we draw on this place in ourselves that is the most important thing. And so when we come to programming the work, it's a different matter, and it's a real risk, because we want the plays that we program to be robust. You know, we want people to come. We want people to like it. We want it to be achievable in, you know, 4 weeks or whatever crappy process you set up for yourself. And the problem with being robust, we want the plays to be on solid ground. But being on solid ground is not what the work is. The work is not on solid ground. The work is about being the rug being ripped from underneath you. That's the nature of what we do. And I'm looking forward to today, look at us today, where the conversation is no longer on the surface of things. We're no longer talking about safe programming decisions. And I'm very much looking forward to watching all of us grow and share our stories, all of our stories, in much deeper waters.
Of being a playwright, a feminist, and a member of the board of the Abbey Theatre. And I want to say that I welcome this conversation with all of my heart. On a personal level, I've worked in theatre for 16 years, and I always felt I laboured under a gender bias. I couldn't understand it, but I felt it. And being an artist, I trusted that feeling. I trusted my gut. The statistics quickly showed me that they were there to back me up. So I, like many other women, raised gender bias at board level, at conferences, on platforms, and in the media when they were discussing my plays and my work. But I was always made to feel a little bit like a screamer in the corner, because it wasn't a popular viewpoint. And what is amazing about Waking the Feminists is that this movement has brought the argument center stage. Women are no longer in the corner looking in, but back at the very heart of everything we do. And arguments that I had to listen to less than 3 weeks ago, such as, I know it's not great, but percentage-wise, it's pretty much akin to UK theatres, just no longer stand, because the world has turned and the ground has shifted and we all want better. Women do not write lesser plays. Women are not lesser artists, and women are not lesser citizens. The challenge now for all of us, board and sector included, is what action we take to implement change. Because change is what's good for the Abbey Theatre. Change is what's good for artists and art across every genre. And change is what's good for Irish society. There have been a few false starts for feminism in the 100 years that Ireland has existed. I truly hope that Waking the Feminists is a new beginning.
To everybody for their contribution. I grew up in this theatre. I was thinking about the legacy of 1916. I was thinking about war stories, about poverty, about housing, about disenfranchisement. I was thinking about the Middle East. I was thinking about Northern Ireland. I was thinking about international touring. I was thinking about the Abbey Theatre's canon. I was thinking about new commissioned plays on my desk that were at final draft stage. And I wasn't thinking about gender balance. I did not look up. I did not ensure that our 2016 programme would represent the experience of the nation as a whole, male and female. To use Una Murphy's phrase, rather borrowed phrase, I failed to check my privilege, and I regret that. Privilege is not just about structural social advantages of birth like being man, white and middle-aged. It's about who gets to talk, it's what Grace is saying, and who has to listen, it's what Gina is saying. I should have stopped to consider how my privilege affects the things I say and do. Society is overwhelmingly biased towards the male narrative, towards me. I see it in the government. I hear it in the voices, or more importantly, the absence of voices on the radio. I should have implicated myself in that issue by checking myself and applying the same analytical eye to my world, the arts world. I'd like to share with you what I've learned over the last fortnight, and indeed today and this afternoon. I have learned that we can't have true artistic freedom until we have gender equality in our industry. As long as female artists continue to be underrepresented in Irish theatre, we're all missing out on important and exciting work. It's painful for me personally, but it's painful to think the images, stories and perspectives that have been lost to us already throughout history. I have learned that I should use statistics or stats as a provocation, not accept them as fact. Fewer women enter the playwriting industry than men. Why? What barriers are in place to stop them? What investment can we make to change those numbers for the better? Theatres across the UK and Ireland receive fewer unsolicited scripts from women than they do from men. Why is that? How can we change the system to motivate the many great women playwrights to send them to this theatre? Visibility is what is essential here, and I agree with what Nancy Harris has said. Seeing and producing plays by women on both the stage of the National Theatre. Commissions are vital, but productions are paramount. I learned that a 50-50 gender balance in commissioning won't balance out decades of invisible women. Under the weight of centuries of male privilege and an overwhelming male canon, some positive affirmation intervention is required. For a time, I need to commission more women than men to redress the balance. I can't wait to read the 8 plays by female playwrights we currently have under commission. And I'm excited too by the work yet to come from the 13 talented female graduates of our new playwrights programme. I learned to take and to look at initiatives like Tonic's theatre work in the UK and the Jubilee project in the US, which is an amazing project, for pathways to sustained gender balance. We want to achieve gender equality on our stages, not just for a season, but for the long term. And I'm listening to what Roisin said, and it's a good idea to start from scratch and start to re-look and re-examine through contemporary eyes, through other eyes, the canon of playwriting over the last couple of years. We have to acknowledge in this theatre today
platform. Instead, we said, okay, let's look at the platform. And it's been said today, it's about the structures. And we thought, well, actually, on the limited resources we have, and the limited money, energy, capacity, time, rather than us making plays, let's work with people who already do. And above all, let's work with the biggest, highest profile, best resourced institutions across the country, the majority that get, those that get the majority of the public subsidy and the majority of the public's attention. And our thinking was actually if we can work with the Royal Shakespeare Company or the National Theatre, organisations that might be producing 20 productions a year, actually if we can change the way they think and they do and they communicate and they assess what artistic quality is, then we will really begin to shift things. Because nobody has yet been able to give me any scientifically proven evidence that men are somehow biologically better disposed to write plays, or to make create lighting designs, or run theatres. So therefore, if men are not biologically better engineered to write plays, if when you put together a season of work, overwhelmingly that work is by men, the problem is not with the women, the problem must be in your structure through which you select which writers you want to commission, which old plays you want to survive, revive and survive through reviving. The problem is in how you build relationships with those writers, with how you communicate with them, with the exchanges you have, with the ambition that you do or don't set for them. I spent quite some time looking at work that had been done in the UK, which was designed to increase diversity in the arts when I was setting up Tonic. And I couldn't find many schemes or initiatives that were specifically about women in theatre, but in terms of other areas of diversity, quite a lot of work had been going on in the last sort of 10 to 15 years. And overwhelmingly, it had not achieved the results that it should have done. There were some definite positive outcomes, but overwhelmingly, considering the time and money and effort and goodwill that went into a lot of them, they didn't achieve as much as they should have done. I could talk all day about why that is, but one key reason I would say is that they tended to focus almost exclusively on the underrepresented group. What is it about that group of people who are not in our workforce or aren't in our audience? What is it about them? Of course you need to understand that if someone isn't engaging with your organisation, either professionally or as an audience member, of course you need to understand why that is. But what almost never seemed to be happening with those works was that they never encouraged institutions, gatekeepers, to reflect on themselves in tangent with that. To think, how do we make choices? How do we work? And so that is instead at the centre of what Tonic does. So just to give you one example before I know my time is up, our advanced programme is a piece of work that we are actually about to begin again next month. We previously ran the programme in 2013 going into 14, where we worked with a cohort of 11 leading theatres over a 6-month period of time. We worked with their artistic directors, chief executive and senior artistic staff, and we said to them, okay, Just choose one question that you want to answer. Don't try and deal with gender equality in a 6-month period. You'll drive yourselves mad and achieve very little. But instead, just work out one thing that's important to you. So one theatre asked about their commissioning process for playwrights. Does it suit men better than women? Another asked, okay, well, what's the trajectory for assistant directors going into directing? How can we ensure that any discrepancy between men and women is removed by us? Somebody else asked, well, why is it that we and our colleagues tend to put plays by women on in the smallest houses but are less likely to do so on the main stages? And over the course of 6 months, we really looked into that. And it was a combination of them looking outwards at the people they weren't currently working with or only working with to a certain level, but it was also crucially about them reflecting on themselves in a very, very structured way. Alongside their own line of inquiry, then, of course, there were the 10 other lines of inquiries of the other theatres. And what we would do over the course of the process is we'd repeatedly bring those theatres together in a room so they could talk about what they were finding difficult, they could share ideas, they could egg each other on, they could exert very positive peer pressure on one another to do better. And collectively, it was just about dreaming up a new way of being, a more productive, So I suppose I offer that as just one example of the kind of work that can really create a tangible shift. Just to finish off, there was something that was said, that group of theatres, they then requested when we got to the end of the programme, they said, oh, can we keep meeting up as a group? We find it really useful. It really keeps us on track. So now we meet every 6 months. And I ran one of the meetings a few months ago, so we had a lot of those artistic directors in the room, and one of them, who's a man, a white man, he was sort of pondering, we're having a conversation, and he said, oh, so, we were talking about leadership, and he said, so I guess what we're saying here is it's not about getting women to the top of organisations, it's about getting feminists to the top of organisations. And I went, but actually I think there is something in that, because this is not something for the women to do on their own. It has to involve all of us, regardless of gender. If you're not a feminist, go and find out about it, because I promise you,